Respected Chairperson, Dashmesh Educational Charitable Trust, Srimati Madhupeet Kaur Chawla, Managing Trustee, Sriman Mohan Singh Chawla, Pro-Chancellor, Professor Dr. T.D. Dodra, Vice-Chancellor, Professor Dr. Shyam Singla, Pro-Vice-Chancellor, Dr. Dilip Singh, Registrar, Mr. T.K. Sharma, Dean, Examination and Internal Affairs, Professor Grover, Dean Academics, Professor Mahapatra, University Officials, Director Medical Medical Sciences, Dr. Cody, faculty, deans of the faculties, heads of the departments, and faculty members, and my dear students. A very good afternoon to you all. It is my proud privilege to introduce and welcome our guest speaker today, Dr. P.C. Jain. A renowned educationalist with a brilliant academic career, he was a rank holder throughout. He topped the University of Rajasthan in M.Com in 1971 and got associated with teaching at Sriram College of Commerce, University of Delhi. After his PhD in 1985 from Delhi University, he did his postdoctoral research from Indian Council of Social Science Research in 1989. Dr. Jain has, to his credit, a long experience of teaching postgraduate management courses in SRCC, University of Delhi. He has been a professor, Entrepreneur Development Institute and Vice Principal, SRCC, before becoming the principal of the same institute in November 2005. He has also been the Founder Course Director, Postgraduate Diploma in Management, Business Entrepreneurship, ETI, Ahmedabad. Dr. Jain has written 13 books and also contributed more than 30 research papers presented at different national and international seminars. For his valuable contributions during his illustrious career, Dr. Jain has received Best Management Teacher Award in 2001. He was achiever of Escort DMA Best Book Award and nominee as Man of the Year 2004 for Academic Excellence by ABI, United States of America. We welcome you, sir. I request the dignitaries to kindly light the auspicious lamp of knowledge. Dr. P.C. Jain for his talk, Success Strategies for an Educational Institute. Welcome, sir.
Honorable Chairman and very esteemed academicians, you all know that I have come just from a college, but it is almost a university, it is already a university. So, university means vice chancellors, pro vice chancellors, deans, registrars, and senior faculty members, professors, and so on. Virtually, I come from a college where there is hardly any professor. We have just associate professors, the maximum. And if you go beyond that, you can be a principal, maximum, if you are lucky enough to become the principal of the college. But when I asked my faculty members, why don't you be a principal of the college? And many of them don't agree to that idea of becoming the principal of the college. I don't know why they don't want to be the principal of the college. Becoming a principal of the college is really honor, a great honor. I believe honor more than a president or prime minister of this country, because you are directly involved in transforming the life of a student. A student who comes from any part of the country, any part of the world, rather, sometimes I can say. And you are the only person in the world, meaning by the teachers, the faculty members, who can selflessly transform a person. Even parents are selfish because they can say, look, this is my son, this is my daughter. He is earning this much, he is earning that much, he is on this position, she is on this position. But teacher is the only person in the world who just celebrate, honor a student publicly from the dais without any expectation, in the sense I can say, with almost 43 years service in SRCC, and after that associating with the SRCC for 2.5 years, I have not asked a single student. Single student means any alumnus of the college, which I taught over a period of 40 years, that you do a single favor to the college, just to maintain the dignity of a teacher and just to maintain the dignity of a my institution, that is called Sri Ram College of Commerce. Because once you start asking favors, you are lowering the position of yourself as a teacher in the presence of the principal. After all, teacher is the only person in the world who always gives something to the society rather than taking something from the society. His ample opportunities and ample, resources at his command. And when we are talking of the higher educations, I'm just narrating a single incident. We were asked by the Prime Minister in his office, probably on 19th July 2016. And my chairman asked me to go along with him. And we went to the UGC chairman's office, Professor Ved Prakash, because he intimated us that you have to meet the PMO at 3 in his office. When we went to his office, had a cup of tea, and then we asked, let us go to the Prime Minister's office. Then he said, sir, you have been asked. I have not been called by the Prime Minister. PM. Naturally, I said, you are looking after the higher education of this country. And higher education of this country is at your mercy. We are simply a college principal or a college chairman. We don't know anything beyond that. Then he said, the impression of the PMO is, I am the biggest hurdle in improving the quality of higher education of this country. So it is an honor for you that you have been called by the PMO to discuss few things about higher education of this country. When we meet the Prime Minister, PMO at 3 on 19th July 2016, his first question was, how many students you have in the college? My chairman asked me to just give me a hint, can you please tell? So I told that we have around 2,500-600 students in the college. Then his next question is, how many students you can add to your college? The chairman again hinted to me that you please reply. I said, sir, I can't add even a single student in the college. Then he said, why? I said, we cannot add this student because college is already overcrowded and there is hardly any space in the campus. And campus is a heritage building, we cannot go for construction, extra construction in the college. And therefore, we are happy. Then his second question he put up before us. Then he said, in case if we provide you a land free of cost to Delhi, NCR, any part of the country of your choice, will you like to add one more SRCC? The chairman again hinted that you please reply, Dr. Jain, what we want to say. I said, no, we don't want any SRCC, one more college in this country. Then he said, why? I said, the governance, because it's a government-aided college. We are only a college, vice chancellor is there, all big people are there, including UGC and all. The regulatory framework of higher education in this country is worst. They don't allow you to innovate, they don't allow you to experiment. So then he said, we have 6 options. One is called Constituent College, Affiliated College, Autonomous College, Deemed University, and Institution of National Importance. You make a choice and we'll give you a status of that particular level, maybe university, maybe. Then again, I said, sir, all these options are useless. then they cannot improve the quality of higher education in this country. So when I said this, my chairman was a little disturbed that the Prime Minister is giving us the options one after another, and we are saying one after another, no, 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 no. Then he suddenly come out with an example that few years ago I worked in Calcutta, some trust, some ashram or. So he said, we thought of starting a university 20, 30 years ago with this objective that we can produce Nobel laureates in our university. I said, sir, this is the issue before the country. We are the country of 125 crore population. You always claim, wherever you go to the public, that I have 1 billion or more population in the country. But it is a shame for all of us that we don't have a single university, single institution, which we can claim that is the top among 100 or 50 even sometimes, or 200 or 250 or something like this. So that is the tragedy of higher education of this country. Then he suggested that you already said no to all questions. So I request you to, can you work for 3 questions? One question is that what is the problem between Delhi University and Sri Ram College of Commerce, of governance or regulation or something like this. And then second, in general higher education of this country. And finally, a note on world-class university. And now you must be knowing it by now, the already there is a concept so-called world-class university. And that is on the website of UGC, HRD, and so on and so on. So there is already a concept. And government is shortly planning to have 10 private universities as world-class university, or 10 private public as a world-class universities. And some framework is already there. And recently when we talked to our education minister, Jawadekarji, then he said, no, this there is no upper limit like 10 or 10, but we already put, but if more applications will come, we can consider to be considered as a world-class university or something like this. We want to groom the university where we can produce Nobel laureates after 10 or 20 or 50 years from this country. So what I can say, there is ample scope of improving the quality of higher education in this country. But by simply giving a framework, can we improve the quality of higher education in this country? I think no. We cannot have a world-class university until unless we have very committed, very dedicated, and I can say a person who can work for more than 20 hours if possible for the growth of an institution. I just want to give a few instances from my own college, how we built SRCC over a period of time. And we built SRCC step by step. I can't say that world class, because we are only affiliated college, and if you go through this concept note of Government of India, world class universities, they start with deemed to be university, and institution of national importance. Even they don't consider colleges like us affiliated or constituent or even autonomous college. And you must be reading nowadays in the newspapers that there is a lot of hesitation within Delhi University. Even today, people are moving from Mandi House to Jantar Mantar against autonomous status to a college. We are not ready to change. We don't want any change. The service has become almost an employment. And we are an employment where there is no challenge. I mean, nobody can question us for next 40 years. And believe me, 40 years plus till death, government have already made a provision that you will be given a pension. So once you join a college or university in Delhi University, you are assured till death for your emoluments, for your service conditions, for virtually everything. So you are totally secured. Now the question is, why you will work? What is the need of doing anything? why to teach, why to study, why to work, and so on and so on. And I also understand, whatever my understanding is, the teaching community is very sensitive community. Sensitive in the sense, very respectable community, and they expect respect from the society, from students, from authorities, from everyone. So I realized that this is the weakness of a teacher, since I already been a teacher in the college for so many years. And I make it a point that God has given me an opportunity to serve as Principal Sri Ram College of Commerce. And I serve it with all honesty, with all dedication, with all commitment, and I can say, whatever I can have at my disposal, I will serve. And first job, because after all we are running a college for students. So I asked my student to gather like this in the auditorium and ask them to write a small note. And the note title is SRCC of my dreams. Because every student come to a college with some dream, some expectations, some aspirations, something to achieve, something they want to be after that college 3 years. And you will not believe, and I also announced that I will give the best prizes to our students, because I know we cannot prepare a roadmap of our college. If I'll ask my 120 faculty members, I know 90% will not respond. And if 10% will respond because of whatever reasons, they will respond, they will say light badal dijiye, air condition badal dijiye, class mein table theek nahi hai, chair theek nahi hai, something like this. So I thought ki, let me go to the student and let they should decide the destiny of SRCC. So they come out with a wonderful write-ups, which I cannot imagine even myself. So their commitment, their requirement, their need, rather their dreams, become the agenda for PCJM as a principal, Sri Ram College of Commerce. And first thing is naturally the quality of teaching, we all understand. And the syllabi is decided by the University of Delhi or UGC, and we know how the syllabus is prepared by University of Delhi or maybe UGC, cut and paste here and there. So I prepare my teachers without telling them that we have to improve and we have to fulfill the dreams of our students. I prepared some schemes in consultation with my chairman, sir. By asking a teacher, they will not respond. But create a system, create an ecosystem, an environment where some may feel motivated and later on others may copy that model over a period of time. So we had a scheme like financing our faculty members for conferences, workshop, maybe organizing within the college or may attend outside the college or maybe any part of the world, from 5,000 to 1 lakh rupees. 5,000 for Delhi, then 10,000, then 50,000, then 1 lakh rupees maximum for that. They can organize or they can even go and attend the seminars. Then another scheme, we can go for publications. If you make a publication, and we just classified the journals, category A, B, C, D, for India and for abroad, A, B, C, D, E. The remuneration for publication will be 20,000 to 1 lakh rupees. And I know that they cannot publish in the first attempt in the best journal of the world. I know the plus strength and weaknesses of my colleagues very well. So I thought, ki, let us make an experiment. And in case if their article is cited by someone else later on after publication, that is what normally we call it, citation. So then 20,000 for each citation he or she will get as a remuneration from the college. Okay. So in case if your article is cited by 10 people or 20 people or next 20 years, if continues for citation, for every time you will get 20,000 rupees. So it's a good amount. But how to initiate? So we started a fellowship scheme. That as soon as your teacher will join, we'll give him 5 lakh rupees. Or if he or she completes PhD, 10 lakhs rupees. And then the senior fellowship for 15 lakhs. And in this way, we said, who will start writing a paper? Or a case, or a project, or anything. He or she will be given 5 lakh rupees in 1 year's time. And the mentor will be a person, a faculty member who is already PhD or something like this. So there is an incentive for those who are already in research, means they are already PhD PhDs, means doctors, to be a part of that scheme. And they sometimes motivate the young teachers, look, why don't you go for PhD or writing a paper, you will get 5 lakh rupees. Because they know their interest. Suppose they guide 3 or 4 teachers, at least they will get 20 lakh rupees in that particular process. So the incentives for a faculty member become more attractive within the college than the outside the college. Otherwise, teachers used to take the class for 2-3 hours, and best part of rest of their time they start earning money here and there, because they are the teachers of commerce college, so they can engage anywhere. So, but you can't ask a teacher not to go. Unless you create a situation for them that leaving the college is a disincentive, or staying in the college will be more incentive, then automatically they will be in the college. And now they were getting 5-10 lakh rupees per year over and above their salary is 50-60 thousand, maybe 6 lakh rupees or something like this per year, but their incentive may cross 5-60 lakh rupees per year. And once you are in the trap, as soon as your first paper publishes, go for presentation and go for citation, then you can go for second paper, then third paper, then fourth paper, for PhD, for postdoctoral, and so on, where you will go ultimately. Because the best source of income you already created in the system. This functions very well, I tell you. Honestly, without asking a teacher, you go for publication or writing this or that. They start working. Initially, you know, those who are not in mood of writing or doing all these things, they used to say, this publication work, writing of paper is cut and paste. I said, okay, at least I wish that you should be excellent or good in even cut and paste business. Do it. Because there are programs nowadays available which can check your copying or cut and paste or something like this. So you will be in trouble. Institution will not be trouble. Institution has created an opportunity for you that in case if you want to add to your income, not going outside the campus, this is an option. And the implication is most of the teachers are available in the college from morning 8:40 to 7, 8, 9, 10. The another reason why they were staying in the college over a period of time, as I normally feel, and this scheme is not only for teachers. This scheme is there even for non-teaching staff, means support staff, and for students also. And sometimes I carry along with me number of my students whose paper have been accepted abroad, and we paid for that. So once a student go outside the campus, you can imagine the amount of confidence that they have. And sometimes, believe me, sometimes student give a better presentation, better articulation than even to my faculty members, sorry to say. So, but ultimately student makes the difference. Ultimately student will make the institution, because ultimately they will become the ambassador of your institution after leaving the campus. And I made it a point all my faculty members and to all my non-teaching staff that if you will give a bad experience to any student in this college, he or she will speak till he will survive outside the campus the bad experiences wherever he or she will be there. Or if he or she has a very good experience in the institution, he or she will always speak good for the college. So why don't you do that? Why a student leave an institution after 3 years with a bad experience? And not only for my students, I normally, almost every year, beginning of the admission process at the college, I call my all non-teaching staff people. We know 50,000-60,000 applications will be there. We have to admit 250 students out of so many. Almost 8,000 to 9,000 parents will approach us. We have to say no to almost 9,000 people every time, every year. But how to say no, that is important. No one is going to force us to admit any student without any merit, but we have to be very courteous, we have to be very, very, very supportive, very considerate, very honest in our behavior to our non people who are visiting our college. So this is how you build your faculty, your staff, your students. And imagine when I joined the college as a principal, first day of my college principal. As you all know, sometimes employees are taken on the basis of compensated ground. Kisi ki death hogi, kisi ka ye ho gaya, kisi ka wo ho gaya. You put the people in the college, in the service. They are not trained. They are not skillful. They don't know how to work. So first day, in the 40-45 temperature in the month of April or May or June, first day, I call 3 Malis from the garden in my principal's office and offer a cold drink. And I just want to send a message across the college that every person in this college is important for me. And all are equal to the principal. No one is, there is any distinction. And this message spread in the college within seconds. And everybody wondering how a principal can entertain a Mali in his office and with so much hospitality or something like this. Very, I just heard so many, and I know they are not skillful. Ultimately, I shifted them from garden to some library or some other place after providing a reasonable training to them. What I want to say is that every person in the institution is important from top to bottom. And believe me, if you go to the college, you will see every, from PN to the principal, working environment or sitting place, working place is virtually the same. Every fourth class employee today sitting in SRCC in similarly centrally air-conditioned office like a principal of the college. Rather, their offices are more decorated compared to the principal's office in Sri Lanka College of Commerce. So how much you boost their morale, their self-actualization, their self-respect, their dignity, how you recognize publicly for their small achievements here and there. Ultimately, they have to run the college. Principal is nothing. His principal is virtually zero. And I also made it a point for all my students that there is no need for any appointment to meet the principal. He or she can meet the principal straight. My PA to the principal, PA to the principal normally complained to me, sir, you spoil the decorum of the college principal office. I said, you will run the college. Let the student should run the college. Their first-hand information is more important to me than anything else. So why should somebody should be in between me and my students? And that gave me a lot of input about the working of the college. There are some areas, because ultimately teacher makes the difference. Sometimes teacher don't teach, sometimes teacher don't study. And they are teaching for the sake of teaching for over a period of time. 30 years, 10 years, 20 years. I can give examples. We teachers said, at the time of retirement, sir, I need, because condition is that you have to take the NOC from the library. They said, sir, we never visit library for last 10 years or 20 years. Why you are asking from NOC? See the fun. A teacher, without entering in the library for 10 or 20 or 15 years, is teaching the subject. We can imagine what he or she may be teaching in the class. So they are not, but then, because I understand all these things being a part of that institution, though, what I did is, as we all understand that in colleges, normally if a teacher is absent, there is no alternative. So you enter in the college, in the class, and just informally talk to the student, what is going on, who is teaching what. And believe me, you can ask my librarian, every book, because we are around 80 lakhs budget for our library, though it is a college library, choti, small library, but every book passes through the principal. So I know almost virtually every book which has been purchased in the library. And what is the beauty of that book, in short, abstract form. So I enter in the class, and I know that this, because also I know some of the teachers in my own way. So I tell the student, look, you have to ask these points to your faculty members in a very humble way, in a very decent manner. They should not feel that there is a the student is leg pulling or something like this. So in this process, when a student asks, certainly teacher will say, I will do it tomorrow or day after tomorrow. He or she will certainly go to the library. Then I will ask the library person, and library person will tell me, look sir, this faculty member can, this book he or she has issued. So my purpose is, sir, why should I tell this to teacher? Because telling a teacher is a very difficult job. To go for a book or to read or discuss or study or something, it's very tough. It's beyond my imagination. But there are ways and means where you can force a teacher to read or write or discuss or study or whatever you can call it. So this is how. Now comes to a syllabus, curriculum. I believe the first condition, in case if we want to make our institution world class, that is the faculty only. Only faculty. Even in the last meeting with my chairman, though I am no more a principal of SRCC, but I said, sir, we have to do something more for our faculty members to enrich them. And then he said, how much cost will take? I said, sir, it will be around 1 crore rupees, something like this. Then what is your strategy? I said, I am missing few things in the college, which I could not do in 9 years' time or 10 years' time. And I want to see that this thing should happen in the college. Then he said, what you will do? I said, sir, we are teaching papers suggested by UGC, and the syllabus is also decided by the UGC, but it is a third grade syllabus, not challenging, not useful. Then he said, what is the concept of deciding the curriculum? Because after all, he's a businessman. So he asked me, I said, teachers normally say, that students are indifferent, students are not interested, students bunk their class, and so on, so on. How to make the class interesting? Actually, this is a teacher's job. Class management is a teacher's job. It's not a student job or principal's job or chairman's job. In case the content which you are teaching to your student, okay, look, what a student is going to do after your graduation. Either he or she will go for higher education, join some professional course like CA or CAS or something like this, or for MBA for higher education, or go for startup, or maybe maximum students, 70-80% students either go for professionals, go for higher education, or for jobs, or few people, 10%, 15% go for startup. If a teacher can relate any content of the syllabus that, look, gentlemen, this content is going to help you in getting admission in higher education, getting a job, entry for professional course, or for your interview in the job. I can guarantee a student will sit in the class more than you are expecting. But if the student comes to know that I am studying for the sake of examination, just passing the examination, I can understand the student with 97-98% marks, passing an exam, you know, is nothing for them. Because the university set papers for 70 colleges, not for SRCC. And for a college where 45% cutoff students are already there in the university. So paper is so simple, paper is so mechanical, that if you read the syllabus, small note kunjis here and there, even then you will get 90% marks, because basic intelligence is there. So how to create a challenge for a student, and therefore you add the contents. If you cannot add the content, being a university syllabus, then who stopped you to teach extra? Some extra contents you can think of, that this content. But if you do a small exercise of your own, I am telling you, that how this content is going to build the career of a student as a profession, as a for higher education, for a job or for startup or for anything, any progression, I can guarantee student will listen, student will enjoy, and student will ready to even work hard, because they have come for some achievement, not to fail in the college. And no student in this world has come to the college or the university to fail or just to pass time or just to gossip. They are passing time, they are gossiping because they are not getting what they are. I mean, I'm just giving the example of another teacher. One teacher was not teaching for last 6 years. Okay, he was permanent teacher, you can't touch him, but he was not teaching. He was economics teacher. And normally he put his timetable afternoon. So student hardly is there in the college. So he goes to the class, stand up in the podium, have a laptop. We already provided them a laptop and just play games. And when I had a round, so I normally see there are no students. When I ask the teacher says the students are not there. And when I ask the student says, sir, why to waste 55 minutes in the class, because zero value addition in the class. Imagine the system is so dirty. Callous, farce, cheating, open. You are getting salary without teaching a single class. So one day I just met the man in the corridor. Just a matter of chance. It was probably in March or April, something like that. I asked, look, I can guarantee you can serve this college for next 43 years. Without teaching a single class, no one is going to question you. Imagine, have you ever faced the student in the class? If somebody, I mean, ask yourself, you will not have an experience of taking a single class in your lifetime. It's such a dirty system. Then he said, what should I do, sir? Look, if your sons and daughters will ask you, what will ask you, what are you teaching? Because everything, you know, one day, because peer group already start talking about you. So you think for yourself that even after being in the college for so many years, I did not take a single class. So he said, sir, what should I do? What can you do? I am suggesting a mechanism. I said, look, there are 8 contents, 8 modules so called in a paper. You just prepare one. You just prepare one, not rest 7, forget. I'll manage through some other teacher or something like this. Student should not suffer. Your 3 months time, I'll provide you all the materials, all PPTs, all literature, all books, all support, and this between you and me. No third person will come to know what we are doing, what dirty game we are playing. Then, since you are a very sincere person otherwise, not a very activist type of person. Then he gone through it, he prepared so well, and when he started taking the class, he gained confidence because students were there, students were very happy, teacher is also happy, everything is okay. And recently I visited the college. Then he told me, sir, you transformed me also. And I already submitted my PhD, and after some time I'll be a doctor. So your role as a head of the institution is not only to groom student, non-teaching staff, your faculty members, even to your chairman, your management. Because management has a different thinking process. They are not running the education institutions. They are the businessmen, basically. So even the management needs sometimes a lot of grooming. In case if they wish that their institution should be the excellent one, the top institution in the country or something like this. So this is how you built the curriculum, meaning by adding some flexibility or enrichment of faculty, curriculum, even beyond the requirement of the university or something like this. So till, and since you are the university, you are free to design your curriculum. And curriculum means this 1 crore project is still left. I'm just explaining that part. We have around 50 papers in BCom Honors, BA Honors Economics total, or some master's course. 50 papers, suppose 50 papers. So 3-4 teachers may be teaching one paper in the college, because there are number of sections, 13 sections for BCom Honors, more sections for so and so on. So 4-5 teachers teaching the same paper. Now we will give 1 lakh rupees to each group. Meaning by 50 groups, 50 lakhs rupees, straight 50 lakh rupees is a total budget, 1 lakh rupees to each group. Now each group, meaning by 4 or 5 teachers, will collect all the articles published on that subject. The latest, what is going on, what are the issues, emerging issues about that particular subject, and the books which you have added to our library in last 5 years. You collect all the readings, you collect all the best books on the topic, you can identify 7-8 new concepts or topics or literature or so and so on, and develop a model course curriculum for the sake of fun. So as and when the university will come or the UGC will come forward to redesign the curriculum or something like this, at least you will be available. Otherwise what would happen? As soon as the UGC will ask, the cut and paste will go on, because you don't have time, no one is ready to pay. So 3-4 people will be asked to develop the curriculum. So you develop 2-3 page curriculum, the content, the readings, the evaluation system, and so on, in the complete package. And how this paper and how these contents are going to help a student for higher education, entering into higher education, or for job, or for professionals, or for startup or something like this. You also note down how this, suppose we are teaching bill of exchange, suppose how this concept of bill of exchange is helping a student in getting a job, in getting for higher education, entering into the higher education, and so on and so on. So second thing, I believe, the most important critical part of any educational institution to make it the best, that is the curriculum. And out of your research work, if you are engaged by the way in the process, then there is another advantage. Your teaching will move from dissemination of information to research-based teaching as well as curriculum. In case you come out with a new ideas, you can give a new paper. You have to explore how much useful this concept is for the students. You can come out with a new course and the student will automatically be there. You can create a market. So this is how you can go beyond. And the publication part is relevant, is important, not because just you made 3 papers or 4 papers or 5 papers or 20 papers, you are earning money or something like this. That is not the point. The point is, the spirit behind all this publication is, all people cannot meet you, but all people can read what you can write. So if one paper published in an international journal, the implication will be 1,000 people will read to whom you even don't know. So there is a branding of an institution through publication, not only of yours as an individual, but of an institution. And this way, this is how the publication will help in branding of an institution. So curriculum is there, this faculty is there, infrastructure normally nowadays. I see better than the colleges like SRCC, this auditorium is a better auditorium than SRCC. If you enter the SRCC auditorium, you will say, where I have already come, this is the worst. So infrastructure wise, there is a lot of improvement nowadays. I am observing throughout the country as far as the academic institutions are concerned. The management is very, very, very concerned, very serious about building the infrastructure. And the last point I want to say, suppose you are running 20 courses, 30 courses, courses within courses, departments within departments. Even the Harvard is not good for everything. There are some strength areas. There are certain strength areas of every institution. You can build on them, isn't it? You can build on them, you can pay extra attention to them, so that with one special department or what special specialization, you can build your brand over a period of time. Because building brand takes time over a period of time. So we have to see that all courses may not be as good or as better as of any world-class institution, but few divisions, few departments, few courses, maybe the strength. And believe me, when the PMO asked us, why only one Harvard in 800 years time or something like this? Why? Everybody say, because in one meeting with the HRD secretary, he was very, very, very critical of the principal SRCC. He was very abusive. He was very, I don't know how to express, but he was very critical the principal SRCC. You don't know how to run the college. You don't know the protocol. You don't know this, that, so and so. I said, look, gentlemen, you have 46,000 crore rupees to improve the quality of higher education in this country. But this is my open challenge. You cannot create SRCC in 46,000 crore rupees. It's a wrong misnomer. Institutions are evolved over a period of time. You have to build a culture, you have to build a value system. And it is a very slow process. Lot of patience is required. Lot of, you know, perseverance is required. Lot of nuisance you have to tolerate. Lot of time you need to understand each and every faculty member, each and every staff, each and every student, and customize a strategy. So it needs a huge time on your disposal, and but nothing is impossible. Nothing is impossible. I wish SGT may come forward. There is a great opportunity at the present juncture when the government of India is coming out with this concept of world-class universities, and they are going to help out of the way to the universities or to the education institutions to come out maybe next 5 or 10 years time, world-class universities. And it is not only for the sake of world-class universities, but we can be proud of that India is a country where there is a world-class university means education. And we all understand, we all know, without education, nothing is possible. There is a positive relationship between the growth and development of any nation along with the higher education. So there are a number of small experiments which we try, but in broad, I can say whether SGT will be a world-class university or not, I can say with full confidence, with my experience of 40 plus years in SRCC, it is you, means the faculty, and you alone no one else can make this university a world-class university. Even they spend 100 times money more than what they are spending today. So if you believe, if you work on it, if you think over it, and there are small formulas. I'm also telling you a small formula, how we built the class. Suppose you are teaching a paper for 5 years. If you are teaching X paper for 5 years, don't ask anyone. You take the result of 5 years of your students, of your class, 40 students, 50 students, 60 students, whatever may be the number. And this job I did, not by the faculty members, I did. But you can also do it if your system is not doing it. You do it and see in 5 years' time what is the average performance of that class. Suppose it is 67% of 50 students or 40 students or 60 students. And if consistently it is 67, 68, 69, 65, 64, something like this, it means it speaks that you have to upgrade your education, because your saturation has already come. You cannot teach better than 65% or 67% or 68%. So you need not to, no one need to ask you that you improve yourself. There is a question mark on your own teaching, that by teaching fully all 365 days, the quality is not improving. This means the quality of teacher is not improving, Therefore, there is a need for self-improvement, maybe through training, maybe through workshop, maybe through writing a paper, maybe through doing so many things, so many publications and whatever you can say, there are many areas. But that is the crux. Or if you start improving your performance of your subject, X teachers, so there are 5 people in that particular class. If every teacher's average is increasing 1%, 1%, 1%, I can guarantee in next 5 to 10 years, the overall performance of the class will 100% is going to improve. And not only the performance of the students is going to improve, it is the performance you as a teacher is going to improve, and where you are going to lose. I am telling you, when we offer this fellowship to our faculty members, university people tell us, who are on the governing body, that why don't you put a bond condition that after providing this money to the faculty member, he or she will have to serve the college for 3 years or 5 years, something like that. I said no. In case if a teacher improves his or her competence, he or she is going to serve in any part of the world. So ultimately, his or her competence is not going to be a loss to anyone. Everyone is going to be benefited, whether he teaches in SRCC or any part of the country or in any college or any institution. Why we should put a condition? He or she is not our bonded labor. After all, he is intellectual. Let him move freely. But in case if you support him or her, he will never forget SRCC. He or she will never forget SRCC. He or she will always speak good about SRCC. And that will build our brand over a period of time. So spending money for faculty and improving overall performance of a faculty of the college, I think the critical point is you alone underline the faculty, and motivating factor, the management or the officials who can motivate you. And if you are totally dead person, even after so many reminders you don't want to change, even then there may be some area, there may be some scope, there may be some strategy, there may be some ways in which you can be even motivated. So there is no upper limit, that beyond this no one can be improved. Anyone can be improved, and we have to improve a lot, to be very honest. Country's education has to change. We are bound to change. And if you are not changing, it does not mean others are not going to change. Everyone is making its own efforts. Therefore, why we should not? So I believe if you start making small experiment for yourself, for your development, for your growth, for your competency improving, I think the sky is the limit. Sky is the limit. You have ample opportunities, and you all know through newspapers that institutions are without faculty. There are no teachers. Teachers are not available. Faculty is not available. Faculty is becoming the most critical factor in this country. And we want that everybody should be educated, and we want to be a word guru or something like this, Vishwa guru or something like this. And in that honest process, we must play a very critical role, even if no one asks us to do that. And if we can do something that, believe me, for 40 years, wherever you are teaching, you will transform the life of huge number of people which you sometimes you don't know to whom you have benefited and who has been benefited at what point of time. So that will be a great source of satisfaction to all of us, and certainly we will earn our respect in that process as a teacher, as a guru of the system. I wish this country, with your efforts, will improve the quality of teaching. And whenever we listen that initiative has come from SGT, we will all be proud of it. Thank you very much.